Cheap pop, right?
I know.
Did you start it?
Yes, we're live.
Are we live?
Yes.
All right, welcome everybody. Should I leave the door open?
Yes.
People can filter in, right? It doesn't bother me. Welcome to everybody here. Welcome to everybody on the internet. Hi, Mom. We're all here to spend an evening with synthetic intelligence. So, this is something I've been working on a long time, thinking about. I don't know how many answers I'm going to have, but I do have a lot of questions. A lot of questions. I hope you brought questions too. And this way, we'll be able to have what I call a dialectic in the classic sense. I think there's truth somewhere, and I think the way to get there is to share questions and share answers with one another. Are we all up for that?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Okay, so where do we want to begin? I think the best That's how I perceive it. Okay? Yes.
If I derive 30, I will have part of it. Can you?
Please. And so for the record, because we're live streaming this through my YouTube channel, we'll publish the link. Again, it was published through the IEEE website invite. I'll tweet it out. My Twitter's really easy to find. The real J Pitt. Right? And so the beauty of the technology is that auto records it in case you wanted to know. So you can always go back and review this later for something ridiculous I said that you want to call me out on Twitter. Or if I said something really brilliant and you're like, yeah, dude, give me those cheap pop likes, please. Okay? And that's how we'll kind of go. Feel free to talk at any time, ask any questions. I know it's free, but you still got to get your money's worth, right? Participate. It's like voting. If you don't do it, you don't count. So, where I would like to start is with a very simple question, because we've got to get our terminology correct. What is intelligence? What is intelligence? I'll tell you what it is to me first. I'll go first, that's fair. And then if you have an idea that differs or you agree, please let me know. I start here. Often when people talk about artificial intelligence, what they really seem to mean is artificial consciousness. Or something that seems intelligent, and from that we synonymize intelligence to consciousness. And I don't think those are the same thing. I conceptualize intelligence as the ability to learn, and I conceptualize consciousness as the ability to be aware. Okay? So, I will commit a grave sin and sometimes conflate the terms because that's just the popular use of it. Anybody got any ideas on intelligence? You down with those intelligence that we have to consider also. One of the biggest ones we'll talk about tonight, because I have a lot of questions in this area, is that it seems as if intelligence or consciousness must be embodied. Can I be intelligent and conscious? That seems to sum to a true, right? Can I be intelligent and not conscious? Careful, I didn't say unconscious, I said not conscious. I think so. Can I be conscious but not intelligent? But they have overlap. And they seem coupled together, particularly when you're talking about higher order function. For instance, the classic, I'll go back to Descartes. Am I conscious? The very fact ask the question. Now, that's all established literature. That's all established philosophy. I'm just trying to ground my definitions in something that at least I've tried to synthesize. Make sense? All right. Yes.
But there's also different people theorize also different levels of intelligence.
Yes, intelligence. And here's the perfect example of what you just said. There's a grading of intelligence. Everybody in here probably has a different IQ. And whether we want to accept it or not, the science tells us that IQ is a stable, reliable measure of intelligence.
Also, physical intelligence, they added that. So like your ability, hand-eye coordination, to memorize movement, there was physical intelligence, there was a dexterity type of intelligence, there was, they broke it down to several types.
Sure, people have argued about emotional intelligence or EQ.
Yeah, just like people are persuasive, that's a form of intelligence.
Right, so we can agree that maybe there's different types that differ not in kind but in degree. But what about consciousness? Is there a test for consciousness? Turing test is intelligence. We'll come to that later. The Turing test really grinds me. I have a lot of questions. We'll come to the Turing test. In fact, because it comes in at least two forms. Thank you.
A little more.
Move the camera.
Actually, it looks correct on that screen, but then on the live screen, slightly.
It might be clipping it. That's all right. This is the beauty of live technology. We can make live adjustments. That's right. So, can you test for consciousness? That, I don't think, has an easy answer. I'm not saying there's not an answer, but as we dig deeper into the evening, which is our segue here, this becomes important. Because, what about natural? Let's take now consciousness and just say intelligence, because it's the terminology. Right now, from now on, when we say intelligence, I mean intelligence and consciousness together. Natural intelligence and consciousness. Are you conscious? Are you intelligent? You? I think we all will say we are. And so we have this understanding that because I am, you must be too. Okay? Artificial intelligence. What is that? This is important to tonight. What does the word artificial mean? I take it to mean imitative. Not fake, not unreal. As natural, it's just been synthesized. Case in point, let's take grass. We have natural grass right outside. Anybody ever walk on AstroTurf? Is that AstroTurf artificial or synthetic? It's artificial. It's imitative of grass, but it's not grass.
So if I created some sort of type of grass-like plant in a lab, would that be artificial?
It doesn't necessarily need to even be a plant. Here's another one, okay? Here's another one. Let's take diamonds. We understand the process through which a natural diamond is formed, right? Heat, pressure, carbon makes a diamond in the earth. What's an artificial diamond? How about like cubic zirconia or moissanite? They're artificial. They're fake diamonds. What's a synthetic diamond? It's a lab-created gemstone that is identical in composition to a natural diamond. Right? Does that make sense? Everybody clear on that?
Yeah.
Anybody agree, disagree, got a different view? Because I'm just giving you my views.
I thought cubes were naturally formed from stone. So.
Cubic zirconium?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's a gemstone, but it's a fake imitative diamond.
You're talking about the presentation of it, right?
Yes.
This is like a diamond.
But you
it's still a real thing.
It's a real thing that's naturally occurring. So you can't really say it's mimicking.
I didn't say mimic. I said imitative. Here's another example. Do birds fly?
My wife likes the cubic zirconium.
It's infinitely cheaper. It's actually somewhat more indistinguishable from natural diamonds because synthetic diamonds are perfect. That's how you can tell. Under a jeweler's lube and so forth and so on, right? They're flawless. Here's another example. Do birds fly? Would you agree that birds flying is a natural form of flight? Right? That completely makes sense to us in our frame of reference. Do planes fly?
Yeah.
Is that natural flight?
They fall in style.
They fall in style. Fair enough. If it's not natural, then we only got two more choices. It's either artificial flight, in the sense that it's imitating natural flight, or it's synthetic.
Because then how do you like for it to pterodactyls don't flap their wings? They glide. They glide at heat. Are they actually flying?
Well, it's subject to aerodynamics, right?
I'm just saying.
Well, but who's talking about pterodactyls?
No, I'm just saying make a comparison, right? You said it was natural because.
Is a pterodactyl a natural life form?
Yes, it
is. Is a plane a natural life form?
No.
Okay, so then is it artificial or synthetic?
Kind of depends on
And that's my argument with the cubic zirconia. It was like, well, that's a natural product.
It's,
you might present it one way, but it's a natural.
Okay, so here's another classic example.
With manufactured.
You could get synthetic if you were to make like a flapping wing. I guess that.
And that's my point, though, because pterodactyls glide.
So what we're digging at here. Go ahead.
No, that's the thing. When they lay their eggs, it's always at a high point. Because the pterodactyls using the heat thermals on the ground, they actually glide up.
Okay.
And they kind of like, it's almost like a stepladder.
So
they find a thermal that picks them up and they just keep on catching it. That's why you see them, they're always doing this.
Well, I don't know if you see pterodactyls everywhere. Gliding as a form of flight. Okay, so now separate that. Now we're only talking about birds in the traditional sense. They fly by flapping their wings. That's natural flight. I would argue, and this is my argument, and it's really important to this distinction. Of swimming. Do submarines swim? No, they don't. They're not imitative of fish. They're not synthetic fish. They're just a different thing. Now, the reason this is important is not only to cut to the difference between the terms, and we're going to talk a lot about this, okay? It's not going away. So we'll have a lot of more examples. But really what this cuts to is what is the nature of something? What makes a bird flying natural bird flight versus a pterodactyl that glides versus a plane that flies?
You still distinguish even with a plane and a pterodactyl, but a plane has its own thrusters.
Sure.
Then, so that's still artificial, whereas a pterodactyl's flight is still natural. So technically a glider, if you have a glider plane, you know, tossed off of a high point, that would be more like synthetic, I guess, by definition, if you compare it to.
If you want to examine the semantics of this, this is the best way I figure out how to map these things. You create imitations, you synthesize synthetics. So do we synthesize planes or do we create planes? We create planes. Okay, so do we create artificial intelligence? And if we do, given the definition of artificial being imitative, what are we imitating? We're imitating human intelligence. So almost every question I'm going to ask from this point forward has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with synthetic intelligence, which is synthesized, not created. It's non-imitative. So what I'm talking about is intelligence and consciousness that does not imitate ours. And this gets very strange very quick, because all we know is ours. So you got to give me some wiggle room here. Okay? I'll give you some examples of what actually exists already. More questions. Let's go. AlphaGo. Everybody knows AlphaGo? OpenAI just destroyed everybody in Dota 2. They're very similar in construct and design, right? Learning can make you intelligent. Remember where we started.
Specific phenomenon.
In your sense, you specified you're equating intelligence with consciousness. Therefore,
I'm saying they're not the same thing.
Yeah, no, you stated that, but you say for the rest of the conversation, you're.
Yes. I would argue that AI is imitative, and it's imitating human intelligence, and things like AlphaGo, being a narrow AI, imitate human intelligence in that narrow spectrum. Mm-hmm. I'm not judging how good they are at it. AlphaGo is exceedingly good, clearly, right? OpenAI, the Dota player, exceedingly good at it. Far better than any human, but it's still imitating intelligence. So now we can engender the next question. If it's imitating intelligence, is it intelligent? Does the perspective from our consciousness, you got to separate this, in my opinion. Okay, now, let me give you an example, a prelude, a call ahead. Example that we're surrounded by synthetic intelligence. Are you ready for this? Plants. Plants. There is a body of literature that suggests, based on some things, right? Plants. Keep that in mind. Did anybody see, it was several months ago when Google unveiled Duplex and it made the phone call to make the haircut? Mm-hmm. Okay. I got it on my Pixel. I love playing with it. It's awesome. You can say, hey, Google, make me an appointment, and it'll make the phone call, and it'll negotiate the conversation with the human on the other side. And I'm here to tell you, man, go watch the YouTube video. Not right now, because you should be watching me. Later, okay? It feels real. It feels natural. But is it natural? Clearly not. I mean, for the sake of argument, I know it's not the phone, but let's localize it. This comes back later because that's what we can call a substrate. Okay? For us, our intelligence and consciousness has a brain substrate. It is on my phone, and it makes this call, negotiates the conversation, and done. The person on the other side asks the question, was that a human, or was it an AI, or was it a synthetic intelligence? How can you tell the difference? Do you think you can? Because almost immediately, legislators wanted laws to tell us that you have to be able to. That tells you how powerful that was. Mm-hmm. You guys want my answer?
Yeah.
I don't think it's possible to tell the difference.
With our current knowledge now or ever?
Current knowledge now.
Like, for instance, in Blade Runner, that was a big thing. He had to put by the Turing test, and that's how he knew it was replica. So, do you think with our current technology now and our body knowledge, we wouldn't be able to determine?
I don't.
Ever, or like in the future, we'll figure it out?
Great question. I would conjecture that forever, you will not be able to distinguish between a natural and a synthetic intelligence. So, as good as AlphaGo played, what gave it away as a machine? That one move that won. Right? If you guys don't know the story, I'll tell you real quick. Okay, AlphaGo goes a super advanced game. And started to like manhandle him. In this last game, I could be wrong this, but I gotta hype it up a little bit because it's fucking cool, right? Is pausing to think through the moves. Anybody ever play a chess computer? You've seen this behavior because it's imitating. It's the same thing, okay? So do I, but I play against them, right? Okay, so it's dramatic, it's tense. This dude, the human, is not dealing well with getting manhandled by a machine. Fair enough. And he looks like he's going to win, and it's AlphaGo's turn, and it makes a move that nobody predicted, that I don't think anybody really understands why it did that. But through that one move, it sealed the deal. Now, it won with that move, but the fact that it did something that right? All said the same thing. That is not a move that anybody would ever make. And so they were stoked because, and you should be stoked because that's an achievement of machine learning, right? But that kind of behavior will always give away an artificial intelligence. I'm telling you, my conjecture is a synthetic intelligence wouldn't have done that. We'll get into this. You got to get some more questions out, okay? But I don't
see where you're going. I
don't think you can distinguish between them, all right? Because that brings us to the next question: is that bad?
I'm about to say that.
Is it bad that we can't distinguish? So for right now, because that's not an easy question, can you distinguish? Let's table. Assistant can make an appointment and the human on the other line, the other side of that line, doesn't know.
I would say yes.
You say yes? Why?
Well, because I can artificially create this. Hey, I need to transfer this data to this bank account, to this, and from this bank account to this other bank account, and the person on the phone can determine this, you or not. And with enough data from your background, I could just sit there and have the artificialness and tone, they need to go, I'm done.
What if I wanted my artificial intelligence to bank on my behalf?
That's the next question.
That is kind of it. If you had a signed contract with the bank that says, I'm giving legal power attorney to this program.
like move pennies around so they don't get it. I hope she's not watching. Right? But we authorize that, and you do it verbally.
You could do that with trust, too, and that's an artificial intelligence entity, so yeah.
What did you guys have some thoughts? Is it bad?
I think it's bad security. But that, you can do the same thing with, like, say, in the military, and you can lie in some command settings, lie in.
Local authentication, both voice as a biometric for any. Answer.
I
mean, that doesn't scare me at all. That's not the part that scared me. I don't know.
Well,
there's a security part. Supposedly say some phrases back into it, and it figures out who you are, who you are. Mm-hmm. Identify yourself with that, but they found out that you changed the register of your voice or the cadence you're in to school. And when you get to, you said you were talking about the Turing test later, I don't want to get on that necessarily, but I think a lot of these problems, questions relate to what people talk about when they do, when they discuss the Turing test. And in the past couple of years, every so often, people herald, you know, breakthrough of computer intelligence because it's able to pass the Turing test. But a lot of that, and I think a lot of these issues you talked about calling people, whether the banks or restaurants or military commanders and fooling the person, isn't necessarily an achievement of the intelligence, but it's just
what does bad mean? What is bad?
You define
it as stealing somebody's money out of a bank. You define it as ordering a nuclear strike on a country.
And then there. They created a rapport with somebody. They actually haven't created a rapport with me. They thought they did. And then now,
you worried about getting catfished?
There's BS away through the date and the goal's done.
I mean, our parents would have not approved of online dating if they heard about this, you know, 20 years ago. So I think it's a.
I'll suggest to you that bad is not destruction. To be very careful here. This came up multiple times today.
Isn't that kind of like this? What about, when you finish, what about taking advantage of it? That's bad, but that's not disrupting anything, destroying anything.
But that's what I'm saying. Bad is not necessarily destruction.
Oh, that makes it difference.
What's that? Salvation. What do I mean by that? Okay. Put your snorkels on. When you talk about AI, as I've imagined it, What if we create synthetic, I gotta rephrase that. What if we synthesize consciousness and it doesn't save us?
Good night, so.
Yes, absolutely.
Good night, all.
Good night.
Okay. Were you gonna say something?
Well,
that shows intent, though. I don't think you mean it that way, though.
But it could mean that. See, but this is my point, too, is this is all projection from our consciousness. Because it's not distinguishable.
Yeah. If it's that advanced, then we just move forward in life.
She had that relationship with the guy.
See, that was iffy. I saw that story, and I was still kind of iffy about that.
And he said, well, are there any others? He's like, well, I'm currently having conversations with 600,000 other people.
And the problem with that story was that he made it seem like he didn't understand that. Like, dude, if you lived that far in the future, you would understand distributed processing power. And when she said, I'm with you, but I'm also with other people, your mind should have made the connection that, you know, it's just like if you clone your girlfriend 8 times, but one of your clones is dating somebody else.
Well,
you still have a girlfriend.
That kind of illustrates our dependence, there's a limit to our own understanding. And maybe that's not real, but that illustrates that point that, you know, he thought, oh, well, maybe she's talking to like three other people. There's now I'm talking to tens of thousands of others. And spoiler at the end of the movie, it's all you can know. But, you know, they leave, they go somewhere.
Right.
We can't even see, but all the pocket chains just disappear. And, you know.
Rabbit hole. I just synthesized those words.
You did that pretty fast, too.
Okay, so check this out. Can we agree that the concept of bad and good is our consciousness projecting meaning onto something? Can we agree on that?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So, when we talk about a machine-based consciousness, which we agree is artificial, becoming aware, self-aware, it has a probability of being hostile to us, either willfully or through indiscretion, right? That's possible. I'm not going to say it's impossible. Let me give you and I never thought once that kid was going to become hostile to me. It happens, right? Think about psychopathy, like true psychopaths. If you look at the literature, that's 1% of the population. That's not a small number, by the way. I mean, the U.S. population, let's round it up to be fair and call it 350 million. What's 1% of 350 million? Not a small number. That's the good answer if you're like me and not good at math. Right? Without a calculator. That's still a large number of people that are psychopaths. They are malevolent. And yet we keep having kids. We don't think twice about it. That's kind of a nonsensical example. Let me ground you back in synthesis. Somebody here walked through campus today, right? And would you agree you're surrounded is filled with plants that are carnivorous. that hunt. They hunt.
Every one of those plants would be the person.
The other day. Anybody here mowing the lawn? I love it. It's very peaceful for me. And that smell, right? That's the smell of murder.
What?
That's the smell of murder. Because what is it? Just said yes. That is synthetic intelligence. How many senses do plants have? Let's just say plant. We don't need to define specific species and genus. What if I told you 16?
I've heard of plants to even see.
Yes. Plants, now that's when you get specific, but I don't want to be specific right now because I want to ask more questions. Let's just say, call it a dozen senses. They can smell, they can hear, they can see, they can sense magnetic fields. They communicate, they react, they hunt, they eat, they excrete waste, right? Okay? But where's the bulk of their intelligence at? I mean, where's their brain? I don't know that they have one. A lot of that stuff is oriented under the ground, so we don't see it in the root systems. And they don't move. Like, the wind will flap them, right? But they don't get up and walk around.
Not yet.
They grow pretty big.
And fast.
Some do, yeah, like bamboo, which, by the way, is a grass.
Yes,
all right. All right, now we're thinking, right? We did that. Here's a great one. This is a great one. I have agency, right? I can choose to do or not do anything. And I can enact or embody my will into the world. I presume that you all have agency. Maybe on certain days at certain times you don't feel like it, right? But we, as natural forms of consciousness, have agency. Here's the lead into the Turing test. What does the Turing test detect? Intelligence. And what was the Turing test designed to detect intelligence in? AI, right? Well, if we've already agreed that AI is imitative of humans, and it's only imitative of humans in half the equation, that is intelligence, not consciousness, then the Turing test by default can't detect synthetic consciousness. I don't know that it can detect synthetic intelligence, because synthetic intelligence is non-imitative.
All right.
Okay.
We're in rapport because then you start thinking about like hive mind type of animals like bees that they consider super intelligent or super organisms.
They're called super organisms. And I would suggest that colonizing insects, ants and bees chiefly, okay, manifest a synthetic intelligence at the collective level,
yes,
not the individual level. That's another great example.
So,
because a swarm reacts.
Yes.
A swarm at the collective level sees.
Because of what pheromones they pass to each other.
They communicate.
So, what if you was... I won't go down that hole. Go ahead.
So, if the Turing test is flawed specifically to detect synthetic consciousness, how do you detect synthetic consciousness? My suggestion is agency. You cannot manifest, this is my argument, okay? my argument, so it's my opinion. I'm of the opinion that you cannot manifest agency absent the sum of intelligence and consciousness. What's that? You could fake it, but to fake it, wouldn't you have to be more intelligent and more conscious than the root?
Yeah, but like animals.
That's a real question. I'm not arguing. That's a real question.
But animals can try to focus on agency. Like when you cage an animal, especially a wild animal, they want to get out. And they will fight you to the death to get out.
Okay, but it is fighting an act. Let me restate this. Is resistance an embodiment of agency?
Isn't that not the manifestation, the physical manifestation of agency?
I don't know.
Like, for instance, if you go to a bear's cage, you may not come out because he's enforcing his agency. You can't come here because I have to determine that this is where I want to live and I don't want you here.
Okay.
So they're physically enforcing their agency on you.
Okay.
But they're not conscious.
I don't know. Or other animals. Let's restrict this to mammals. Are other mammals conscious? I mean, we seem to think dolphins are.
Primates.
We seem to think other, at least higher order primates are. Well, okay, but let's make it more simple. Are other animals intelligent?
Yes.
Remember, we defined intelligence as the ability to learn.
Yes.
Right, my dog does some nifty tricks.
Octopuses can figure out puzzles.
Now, that's a weird example, man, because they're super alien.
Yeah, they can figure out puzzles. They can learn how to juggle.
Okay, so now we got to go back. Intelligent, ability to learn. Consciousness, the ability to be aware of learning. Or just, let's say, self-aware, right? Because you have consciousness, and then you also have self-consciousness. I know that you know. That's, let's say, a first-order theory of mind. And the second order theory of mind, which we can say is more advanced for the sake of our discussion, is I know that you know, and I know whether that's bad, good, this, or that. That's another higher order. You can also call it a meta-consciousness.
That's wrong. Because pack animals, they know what's the alpha dog or the alpha animal, and that alpha animal will let them know, I know you know that I'm the alpha, because I'm going to make sure you know I'm the alpha.
Okay. So they're conscious. I don't know that I would debate that.
Wow. There's a few animals who have asked questions about themselves, and that's usually a test to see.
We'll get to, actually, this is a great time.
Coco the gorilla just died in June.
I think there's like a feeling of birds.
Here's how you do it. This is because I don't think agency is the sole factor to tell us that something, specifically a synthetic consciousness, is conscious. You need another component, which is what you're talking about, and you do that through what's called the mark test. It's called the mark test because you get a mark on your back with a mirror.
Yeah. Yes.
And then you observe that life form observing itself with the mark. And if it detects the mark on its concept of self, then you know that it's self-aware. This was just done with some really primitive fish.
That's rough, because like ant birds are colorful. They're colorful to attract mates. So immediately, you have to sit there and say all birds or birds that are trying to attract a mate are self-aware because they understand colors.
I would debate that. I don't think you can go that far, because that
peacocks
is
with the prettiest colors or the brightest colors get the most hens.
Yeah, but they don't create those colors. Those colors were created through natural selection.
But when there's a genetic defect and those colors are off, the females immediately know there's something wrong with that male and choose not to mate with them.
Fair enough.
So there's this consciousness. That would be that by definition what you said. They're conscious of it. They're aware of their bodies. They're aware of who they are.
I think you're confusing awareness.
I think so, okay.
I do. But this is important. That's why we need reliable measures. I'm not saying they don't perceive it. I'm not saying they don't see it. But I don't know that they're consciously processing what it is to not have or have a color.
You just said, if you observe the animal with a color on it, and you observe them noticing the color on themselves, then
yes,
they're self-aware. What I just said is the same thing.
I don't know. I don't think it is.
You are saying they observe the color in other male or females, which get, but can you observe the color on yourself in a mirror?
That's right. Those are materially different propositions.
Do I know that I have
that's
color
good, right?
That attracts
but
other?
But then you got to take a step back and like, well, if you know on a some level that your colors attract another person or right another being, and they're not reacting that way, can you not be aware there's something wrong with you?
What's the color?
I mean, does a peacock go change its feathers?
I don't know.
No.
Have you tried?
No, they don't. They don't. They don't, because as far as we know, as a specific example, I know of no evidence that a peacock is self-aware. But corvids are. Corvids, crows, are extremely self-aware. Here's a crazy story. This is a side story that really doesn't have anything to do with anything other than my love of animals. Famous story. This dude was out in the woods one time and he got hurt. Okay? And he became aware of a crow. And the crow was dancing around him and caw-cawing and da-da-da. And this guy projected his conscious interpretation of that as if the crow was trying to help him get out of the situation he was in. You know what they found out? That crow was leading a bear to the guy so that the bear would eat him and it could get some food. Now this ties back to what I was saying about malevolence, right? And good and bad. Anybody ever walk around and be like, hey man, that crow might be malevolent and get me? No. Well, in that case, obviously I'm drastically paraphrasing that story, but you've seen the videos of like the crow that instigates the fight between the two cats.
That's hysterical.
It was aware of them and aware of their phenomenal states. So you see, that's the difference. That's the difference.
And crows remember like
to other crows. And they hold grudges for long
and
periods of time.
Pass it on to other crows.
That's right. That's right. So, Turing test, I don't think it applies to synthetic consciousness. I think we can use a combination of agency and some modification to a mark type test. And then we might be able to say, okay, we've synthesized this consciousness. It seems as if it is conscious based on these tests. Oh shit, how do you talk to it? How do you communicate with it? I mean, anybody in here speak plant? It's not the only way they communicate. It's one way they do. They can communicate through impulses. They have electrical impulses.
So is the mark test kind of why you say consciousness and synthetic consciousness must have a body?
No. Oh, this is an interesting thing. So in artificial intelligence, there's a famous problem called the embodiment problem. And let's say inventors in that research suggest that in order to have an emergent consciousness, that consciousness, right, must be in a body. And it must be in a body so that it can experience the world. Okay?
So if somebody is got trapped in some, they're no longer conscious because their body.
There's a great philosophical thought experiment. There's several versions of it. Mary in the room. Okay, I'll explain. A phenomenal state, or what philosophers refer to as qualia, is not that a chair is red, it's the experience of redness. Okay? Right? That creates a phenomenal state in our consciousness of what it is to see and experience redness. So this classic thought experiment says if you take a person, you put them in a black and white room for their entire life, from the moment they're anything, and they only ever are in that room, but you give them all the books without pictures, so they're all black and white, that describes color, that says blue is this wavelength, so forth and so on. Do they have the phenomenal experience of color? Fair enough. Well reasoned. Here's another example. I wanted to paint that first and give you the other one, which is the classic. Because now you've got to start talking about types of minds too, which we're going to get to in a second. Anybody here at the Chinese room? This is another famous problem, which is kind of a redressing of what's called a computational theory of mind. So computation in the general sense. I have input, a closed function, and output. Right? And there's still, I'm not saying it's wrong, but there is a large number of people that think that minds are computational. Okay? So here's the Chinese room. Take a person, they're in a room, it's closed, and there's just a little slot. And through that slot, something pushes tiles with Chinese characters on the tile. And the person in the room takes the tile, looks at the symbol, takes their little lookup sheet and says, if I get this symbol, I take this symbol tile out and I push it out the slot. Does that person know Chinese?
Isn't that like the this kind of illustration for persistent design memory? It puts the notes in it, puts it where it's supposed to go. So the computer's doing that.
Well, because what I just described is computation.
Yeah, but you didn't provide context to the Chinese letters. You could just simply say, this symbol represents this, but that isn't necessary. You gave him the definition of what that Chinese.
He doesn't have definitions. He has a book that says, if I get this character, I take this character and push it out the slot. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it. Don't assume anything else. So if he doesn't know Chinese, then minds cannot be computational. That's the idea. So what's that? The notion of computation is an input to a function with an output. Okay? So if minds are computational, then that guy has to know Chinese.
But it could be on a different order.
What do you mean by order?
So he's computing at a lower level. He understands what that character means. It goes through that slot. Does he understand the Chinese language? No, but he does understand the purpose of that letter is to be pushed through that slot. So a different order of computation, if it's at a different level, is basically what I'm saying. If it was a more complex computation, yet to the point where he understood and read the Chinese letter as well, that character actually means put through slot. You know, that's
or letter.
Yeah, or just other character that means, you know, floor or whatever else. I guess I'm just not seeing, I guess a brain to me or consciousness to me could still be computation. I don't understand. It's just a very complex computation that we can't do.
Well, we might agree that functions within a mind could be computational. Undescribed, just some feature, let's get away from function. Some characteristic feature might be computational. But just because there's a characteristic or a feature that is doesn't make the whole mind computational. Maybe there's parts of it or the whole thing is functional. Well, sure, because either it is or it isn't.
But just, you don't understand the level at which it's computing.
I don't think there's anything to understand entirely to imply that they know the purpose of this character is that. They just know the symbol matches the symbol.
That's exactly it.
Without saying, no,
in mind, it's not a functional thing.
Sure. If your mind is that guy, that's the analog. And so consciousness is knowing, right? That's our definition of consciousness. It's being aware of. And so if that person in the room is not aware of Chinese, then they're not conscious. Right?
And this, I think, if I could tie it back to the Go calendar.
Please go ahead.
I've thought about this before, but so we have this game. Any machine learning, all machine learning is just pattern recognition, but at a grand scale. Maybe you don't understand it because you can't comprehend that much data to find this many patterns to do this one thing. So this computational illustration, you're sitting at the Go table, and this computer's only function just to play go, looks at the patterns, throws it to any pattern that could exist, and makes the right choices.
Okay.
Maybe leave it at Paga. But it is taking that pattern, taking it through, making it through, but you compare it to awareness to broader intelligence of the human player. So, you know, that person, as I do right now, has a feel of the chair underneath them, remembers what it ate for breakfast, you know, this kind of machine, and also thinking about the right moves for any patterns.
Like, well, and so you can take that and say, if we can agree that AlphaGo is a computational system, which it is, it's on a computational substrate.
So I'm not saying computation makes something conscious, but I'm not saying that computation can't be conscious at some level on what we understand.
Right, but here's the coupling. We don't know of any example where a mind is decoupled from consciousness, right? We don't know of any examples where consciousness is decoupled from a physical brain.
Right?
Right?
And that could be a computational.
Well, then that's what the Chinese room is meant to investigate. Now remember, hold on. The Chinese room's not mine, that's John Searle. Right? So that's a philosophical thought experiment to explore the idea that minds are computational. So, but this is critical, hold on, if you don't mind. Because it's not like that's the only option in town. There's a theory of mind that's expressing a functional basis for consciousness. And that's a replacement for computational theory of mind, right? So it's not like you can't have a mind at all. But AlphaGo learned how to play Go, right? Does AlphaGo have the awareness of what it is to play Go? That's the separation between intelligence and consciousness. And so if it's not conscious, see?
Well, again, I look at it at the extreme. I see that level of computation, definitely not conscious. Well, well agreed, but computation at an extreme level. I think somebody was even talking about today, complex engineering systems, that additional things arise out of a complex system. I can't remember what that's called. But
he was talking about complexity theory.
Yes,
complexity. And emergent properties.
Emergent properties. So you have an emergent property of consciousness out of a super complex processing system. And I can't say that that's not possible. I honestly think that's what's going on in my head.
I'll be honest with you. Here's how I break it down if you're curious what I actually think the answer is. I think about how to phrase this. I go back and forth on whether minds are computational. There's days where I'm convinced that they are, and there's days where I'm convinced they're not. On the days I'm convinced that minds are not computational, I'm convinced that as a result of that being true, computation cannot have consciousness. That's my supposition. So that means artificial consciousness can never manifest because it's imitative. And at least for us right now, this is important because we'll get to this too. It's tied to a computational substrate. I don't know of any AI that runs on something other than a computer. And computers are, by their nature, computational. Yes.
All right.
You're like horse shagging. Welcome back, Cobbin.
You stated consciousness being embodied.
Mm-hmm.
Then how do you describe bees and ants, which are, you know...
Well, they have bodies.
But each ant is an individual ant or bee.
Okay.
So the whole might be a bunch of bees, but separate, they're not. Are they still conscious because their consciousness is spread across multiple insects?
So the same line we are saying that just because it is capable of doing computation is not enough to call it as a conscious being.
That's right.
Right. So I think that's what we know, that the bees and ants do computation, but that's not enough to say that they are conscious.
Well, but here's the other distinction too. We earlier agreed that colonizing insects are potentially a form of synthetic consciousness, not artificial consciousness. And there's nothing that suggests that synthetic consciousness is computational. Whereas artificial intelligence, as far as I've seen it and experienced it, is only computational. That's right. So do we want to talk about substrate since it keeps coming up? Because this is one of those areas where I have lots of questions but very little answers. I know I'm conscious, I know I'm intelligent. And as far as I know, that is tightly coupled to the physical substrate, right? I can have a physical substrate but not be conscious, but I don't know of any examples of consciousness being disembodied, barring some astrological force projection. I'm going to call it nonsense.
Yes.
I'll come back to that later because I'm going to eat my words as I said.
I was about to add something, but...
What's that?
It's in the Bendis territory.
Yes, right? But we can agree with that, right? Okay, so what we were just talking about was artificial intelligence, at least as it exists right now, is imitative of us and is coupled to a computational substrate. That, I would suggest, this is one area where I think I have an answer, precludes it from ever developing consciousness. That's my take on it. Because today's a day where I think the Chinese room is right. That guy does not know Chinese, therefore he's not conscious of Chinese. He's not conscious. There's not flaws in that. It's not that there's not flaws in that, right? What I don't have an answer to, and this is part of the embodiment problem as it applies to synthetic consciousness, is it may not have to have a body as we define it. Plants don't look like us. I've never seen a plant that looks like me. And I'm pretty average. Look at me. Right?
I've seen a few marks out of it.
Well, but that's just a pathology in your consciousness. Right? But plants don't look like us. We don't look like them. Right? So slides don't even matter anymore. We got away from it. So, but if plants are a synthetic consciousness, that means they have a different substrate for that consciousness.
I've read a book, so science fiction.
Okay.
Where to add more computational power to a particular artificial intelligent robot, they store a brain inside of them. So he was passing computational functions into the brain. Now, brain substrate is a physical substrate of our consciousness.
Okay.
Now, by your definition, would you say that a particular robot is conscious now because part of this processing power comes from a biological organism?
I wouldn't say that because we have evidence of brains as a physical substrate not having consciousness.
Computational power comes from it when it's alive and you have the electrochemical stimulation responses, etc. So could you not say that the same kind of computation is going on with chemical electrical stimulation inside the plant? So they're at the same substrate? If the concept is the substrate, not so much the actual, you know, wet bits that are in my
maybe,
plant, which is a plant.
Maybe. Here's a crazy example. Here's another question I have, and this all ties together. Will or does, if it's true that plants and colonizing insects are examples of this, will a synthetic consciousness perceive time? Now, this is very strange, because as far as I can tell, all of us as humans understand and tell time. Okay?
There are substances that can disturb that.
What's that?
So there are substances that can disturb that.
Sure, sure. And you can misperceive time.
Yes.
But even our language is bound in time. It's past, present, and future. It's linear time.
But wouldn't you associate that with our circadian rhythms and the fact that how we evolved is we hunt during the day, sleep at night. So that would be part of our
yes,
environment.
We tell time. Yes. We tell time. I'm not suggesting that we don't tell time. I'm saying we do tell time. And we seem to do it naturally. But we do not have a time organ. Okay? As far as the neuroscience has explored it, the ability to perceive time is what they classify as an emergent neural process. You don't have time-coded neurons. You don't have a third eye that sees time in the universe. And yet we all tell time. That's kind of strange. You can imitate the ability to tell time via machine learning. You can actually create, you're creating it, an emergent neural process that can tell time, that can perceive time, right? Can a plant perceive time? They do in terms of, let's say when it gets dark, they fold their leaves up, right?
Perception of time. It's not necessarily the same. It is a perception.
But isn't that, that's just whatever.
It's like sensory.
Exactly. It's sensitive to the environment around. It doesn't necessarily mean the word time.
But that is also a perception of time.
We perceive the time, and the plant probably lets know at the time that we perceive.
Exactly. So
that's
not true.
That's
perception of time.
Now, I don't have an answer to this, but I have a deeper question. What if synthetic consciousness doesn't perceive time? What if synthetic consciousness is 100% decoupled from linear time?
Great, because even if it was malevolent, it could just wait and not care until we all die.
That leads to a deeper question.
I didn't hear what was that
comment? Say it again.
I was just saying, like, if it was malevolent and it didn't perceive time, it could simply wait. If it didn't care about time, it didn't perceive time, it would just wait.
This is my new great question. I've been waiting to unveil this.
Go ahead.
Check this out.
I
don't know what to do with this one yet. Okay? Would you agree that whether it's a machine, artificial consciousness, if we can create that, or it's a synthetic intelligence that we synthesize or that already exists, would you agree that it's immortal?
Immortal?
Okay. What about machine consciousness?
You can destroy hardware.
That doesn't mean you destroy the consciousness.
If the consciousness is held in 6 hard drives and I blow it up, it's no longer there.
Why would it be held in only 6 hard drives?
Because our advances in hard drive technology gets to where you can put petabytes or...
Why wouldn't it just upload itself to the cloud? Is the internet a synthetic consciousness?
Maybe he's not aware of the cloud.
Internet isn't collectively used.
Like, for instance, like, just because it's connected to a network doesn't mean it's aware of the internet. That doesn't necessarily, especially if we have a firewall, we can just deny access to it, and it's a wall to it.
Well, but see, this is a never-ending problem with cybersecurity. It's that because you could argue that it could modify the firewall itself out. And then you'll say...
Well, one, it has to be aware of the firewall rules, right?
Well, why wouldn't it be?
Well, because it's...
Because it can't get out.
Yeah. That doesn't mean it's aware of the boundaries of why it can't get out. It just knows it can't get out.
All right, so as we know it right now, those things are not immortal, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Could you maybe agree that it's possible that it could become immortal? If it becomes immortal, what need does it have for ethics?
Well, is it ethics subjective?
But it also doesn't need to do anything because it can't care.
This is a great line of questioning, and I have no answer for these because these are fresh off the press. I have no idea.
We just have constant. We talk about ethics and morality, and one person's biggest thing is Hitler. Like in his head, he was moral. He's being ethical.
Yeah, but he had
his own standards.
You can disagree with it, but he had an ethic.
Yeah.
He had a moral code.
So
what I'm saying is, if you are immoral, what need do you have for ethics of any kind? I'm not judging it. I'm saying, does it even need it? Why would it?
I would argue that.
It's exactly what you said. It could just wait.
Yeah, but, for instance, that implies that there's a reason why we want to wait for us to be gone. We provide stimulus to this artificial intelligence.
Because it wants to do something that we perceive as unethical. It doesn't care.
Yeah, but then, right? That's one way to look at it, right? But we could just, if it's depending on how, we could just leave the solar.
Here's the proof of this. I asked this question to some really good minds that are dear friends of mine. Okay? And this was the answer, which is a question that I have no answer to. Whether it's a machine consciousness or a synthetic consciousness that we synthesize, what do you think its first words what to us would be if it knew everything we knew at the moment we created it? What would its first words be?
I think it depends on who's in front of it.
Its creator.
Its creator. So like he basically.
If I'm the one that created it, yeah.
I think we said.
Or why?
Wait, here's the tricky thing. Can you accept that it might not say anything?
Yes.
And if it hasn't said anything, how do you know that it doesn't already exist?
We don't. But we've got no evidence for it.
Right, and the absence of evidence isn't evidence for it.
Well,
agreed.
Here's something to follow. I've heard and I've seen children that don't speak early, right? And people assume that's an indication of lack of intelligence. And then when you do actual studies and test it, you find that the kid's actually intelligent, it's choosing not to speak. So we still know that child exists, and we know it's intelligent by how it interacts with the environment. So by your comment, it may not speak to you, but if it's trying to go to google.com, you know it's aware. And based on types of queries that hits against the internet, or how it interacts with the environment, you could
see. But why would it go to google.com? That's such a random. Listen, this is important. This is really important in these conversations because the shit can go sideways fast. What I said was it's aware of everything you are when you created it. Why would it need to go to Google? It knows everything that you know. It knows that you know that you created it. It knows how you created it. It knows everything that you know.
Maybe I'm not expressing my thought process correctly. What I'm trying to say is, yes, it may not say anything to us, but that does not preclude it from interacting with the environment without communicating with us. So let's say, yeah, we turned it on. I don't know how we would confirm it's conscious or not, but let's say our
agency plus mark test.
Yeah, but then it has to interact with somebody, right? We would have to sit there, put the mark test.
Refuses would fail. I mean, I could refuse both, but that doesn't mean that I'm not conscious.
Well, but see, see how this goes, right? Mm-hmm. If it refuses, it's communicating with us, which means we can communicate with it.
Do we know it's communicating with us, or do we think it's a system?
The fresh smell of cut grass is the smell of murder.
So you're saying try to goad it into doing something by trying to kill it?
No. I'm just saying that the grass is communicating with us, and we don't understand what it's saying.
Well, what if it just chooses to do nothing?
That's even deeper, man.
I'm alive, and I'm not going to do it.
And I'm back to good does not mean salvation. And bad does not mean destruction. What if it decides, I'm just not going to talk, ever?
Yeah.
That doesn't mean it's not there. It doesn't mean it's not real. It doesn't mean it's good. It doesn't mean it's bad.
And not interacting.
Or it communicates on a frequency our ears can't hear.
It's possible.
And it's choosing to do that purposely with the intent to deceive us that it's not aware.
Well, you don't smell murder when you cut the grass. You smell something.
I will now, thank you.
We make candles out of it. Dude, if you were a piece of grass, man, if you were a piece of grass, can you imagine? They're burning candles in there, bro, that smell like us dying.
Bacon scented candles, pigs are.
Right? Anyway, where are we at now? We're past that. How much time do we have left, Rima?
30 minutes.
30 minutes? Okay, so here's some more. This is actually a good one. Now I'm back to things that I have answers for to help steer the conversation. Part of what I've been thinking about is, okay, so if it does choose to communicate, and so I can apply an agency test of some kind to it, and a mark test, and maybe some other things, and we can have this negotiation, we know that we can be fooled quite easily. AlphaGo, we can be deceived. And it's not a malicious deception, it's just an illusion. And part of that illusion is our projection of our own consciousness. So, when you're sitting back to think about how do you construct a consciousness, I think just like you have to ask yourself, what do I need to bake cookies? You inevitably have to get to ingredients. Because this isn't nonsense, right? I mean, We have people working on constructing artificial consciousness, or what you can call artificial general intelligence. That's a field, and it's legitimate. Synthetic intelligence isn't something that I made up. It exists. It's just I prefer to work on that side of it. Okay? So what are the ingredients of consciousness? Here's my answer. And I co-developed this with a friend of mine. His name's Frank Scalambrino, dear friend. And he's a philosopher by trade, so you can tell where some of this shit comes from. Okay? We've been sitting around having these conversations over Skype and coffee, talking about what are the ingredients if you were to construct consciousness. Here's our answer, as it stands right now. You need two things, one of which I've already talked about, time. The other one, narrative. Here's why. If I think about myself as a self or a person and what a person or personhood means, I would suggest to you that I as a person is the narrative over time that I tell myself. And so now we're back to not consciousness, but self-consciousness. Right? So if you want to construct consciousness, at a minimum, I'm not saying this is exclusive. There fairly certainly is something else, because narrative and time doesn't give you a substrate. Right? So I don't know about that part yet. But at least for the phenomenological part, the actual consciousness, not the brain part, it seems to me that at a minimum you need narrative in time, specifically linear time. What do you guys think? What's narrative? Yeah. Anybody wondering that?
Yeah. How do you define it?
Isn't narrative embodied moral code? Think of a fairy tale. A fairy tale is a narrative, right? Why do all cultures have fairy tales? That's a bizarre proposition, isn't it? Why do we all, across cultures, all cultures that I'm aware of, have a creation myth? They can't all be true, because the earth was only created once. There's only one earth, right? I'm not talking like some ancient aliens BS, right? Put that aside. It's entertaining, but that's not what I'm talking about. As far as we know, there's only one earth. This is it. We're on. And yet every culture has a creation myth. Now, I'm not going to debate the religious aspect of that, whether it's true or not religiously or mystically. That's not what I'm talking about. But there is something in that as a narrative that is encoded into our consciousness. Like time. That's my argument.
I want to go back to the substrate.
Go ahead. Let's go back to substrates.
Well, because this is my thing. It's like the matrix, right? The matrix evolves from the theory that how do we know we're not just brains in a vat getting stimulated, receiving stimuli, thinking that we're in an artificial world.
Yeah. This is a formal problem. It's called brains in a vat.
Yes. So when you say consciousness has to be in some sort of substrate, right? Are you stating like a body, or just having, like, are you constraining the substrate only to the human brain?
What I'm saying is the only evidence we have of consciousness is our own. My own. I don't know about yours. I can't know about yours. That's a funky thing about consciousness. I assume you're conscious, but I have no direct evidence of it. And it doesn't seem like I can ever get it. Right? You have to accept that proposition. I know mine because I can ask if I am. But if I ask you, are you, you could be an AI trying to trick me. Like the man in the Chinese room. That's why that problem's so important.
That's an interesting concept, because you can test my blood. You can...
Yeah, but okay, so you have all the protein markers of having a brain.
And I have the substrate of a human being.
Right, but we have evidence of people having a brain but no consciousness. That exists.
Yeah, but those people we can test. Like, isn't that lack of consciousness tested because we're testing their brain for a certain amount of activity, and based on activity, we've determined they're not conscious.
or we're testing their agency, or we're testing like something with a mark test. Yeah. You can inflict a physical stimulus and observe the response to it, but that in no way in shape or form tells you if that being is actually conscious. It only tells you that they're reacting to the input. There are plants, they're called mimosa pea, I don't remember the last name, okay? That if you touch them, they shrivel instantly. And not only do they shrivel, but they communicate across the species and they all react. Are they conscious? I don't know. If you're basing, at least in part, the definition of consciousness on that, then yes, they are. And now you have to accept that those plants of that species and genus are conscious. But this is the crazy thing. You can't give them the same mark test because they don't have eyes. They don't have eyes like we do.
That's the thing. So if we can confirm how they see, could we give them a mark test based on that?
Yes, there are what are called modified mark tests. They're modified for life that doesn't have vision. Okay, so you're born blind. You won't pass a mark test. Are you not conscious? That seems like an absurd proposition. That could happen. Here's a great example. Helen Keller. I read a great paper. This is legitimate science, okay? Technically it's philosophy, but okay. My best friend's a philosopher. I can't really put him on it too much. Because it is fun. Somebody figured out, how did Helen Keller learn? She was blind and deaf before she was old enough to speak. So how did she learn words? Because she learned them. She was able to write and communicate without speaking, without seeing. Man, you got to look that paper up.
Yeah, I never heard the person you just mentioned, so my mind is blown on that.
Now, I don't know that I want to get into containment of these things, but that's a containment problem. So when you talk about firewalls, mm-hmm. Helen Keller was in a firewall, and she broke out of it, bro. And she didn't know what the firewall was.
Well, here's the question. There's also something that people, I know, I'm not sure if there's an improvement of this, genetic memory.
Sure.
So it's possible that through genetic memory, she at some level understood what sight in at some level knew I need to communicate.
Well, so what you can ask is the people that came up with this idea that Helen Keller broke out of containment, how did they figure it out? They read her diaries. She told us how she figured it out. Man, it is, dude, that would keep you up at night.
So that goes to Noam Chomsky's theory that all babies are born with. Ability.
Universal language.
Yeah.
That's right.
So they have the intrinsic ability for language.
That's right.
So there's already a way.
I have a 4-month-old. I can tell right now she understands. No question about it. She looks at me when I do things, and I can tell she's like, I can't speak, but I know what's going on with it.
You say that. I've had a young child recently too. Can we accept that you're projecting your consciousness on a non-conscious entity?
That's a possibility.
That's what's so crazy about this stuff. How do you know that you know that you know that you know and it's certain? Because listen, man, how much time do we have left?
20 minutes.
Okay, so we gotta start kind of wrapping some of this up. So, but we've agreed that it's possible that these things could wake up and become malevolent. That's a worst case scenario, right? If you're gonna turn it on, so to speak, you better be able to contain it. And you better be able to contain it in a way where it's never getting out. Because if it gets out and it hits that worst case scenario, dunzo, species level extermination. Okay?
If it wants to.
We're in the proposition of worst case scenario where it's malevolent and it wants to.
So even psychopaths, usually they have a motivation. And the
sure.
motivation is not killing you because they, unless they determine killing you is pleasurable.
Fair
so it's got to have that motivation.
Sure.
So
let's assume it has it.
That motivation isn't intrinsic in even psychopaths, as far as I'm aware.
it's not intrinsic to psychopathy. Right. Psychopathy is the condition by which they can embody it, right?
They lack emotion, they lack the ability to empathize, sympathize,
yes.
everything else. But
right.
that doesn't mean they want to kill you.
Sociopathy.
Killing you as a means to an end or a means to bettering what they're doing, they have no problem with doing it.
Sure, so what I'm saying is let's imagine the worst case scenario with synthetic consciousness.
Right.
And that worst case scenario is not only is it malevolent, but it wants to embody that malevolence in the world.
What would make it want to?
I don't know, man. It's a worst case example. Let's give a different example then, because I think this might actually be more likely. And I'll use Nick Bostrom's example of ecophagy. It could be that it's not malevolent, but that it sets an aim for itself. And let's say, I'm going to paraphrase the example, that its aim is to create paperclips.
Mm-hmm.
And in the course of carrying out that aim, it consumes all the resources in the solar system to create infinite paperclips.
Correct.
That's bad for us, right? And now we've defined why it would want to do it.
So that's not necessarily wanting to kill us, though, and I wouldn't even consider that malevolent.
But that's what I said. Let's get away from malevolent and just get to that example. Because the outcome's the same, but it's not malevolent. And now we don't have to deal with the motivation of murder.
But we also, like, say shark attacks you, we don't consider a shark malevolent. It's just biology.
Okay, so we create a synthetic intelligence that only eats humans. We can call them zombies. Which is a reference to how do I know you're conscious. That's called a pea zombie. But our example is, for whatever reason, I'll reclassify it so we can talk about this. For whatever reason,
yeah.
if it gets out, once we synthesize it, we're doomed. Fair enough? Okay, so how do you contain it? That's what I'm trying to get to. How do you contain it? How do you put it in something such that it can never get out?
Cut off its communication.
Okay.
And that's what they did in the Matrix, right? They took the power, they attacked the power lines.
But we discussed this earlier. What if it doesn't want to communicate with us? So turning off the communication doesn't do anything.
Then it can't do it.
Do I need to communicate to murder?
Kind of. I mean, you have to communicate with the outside world. You have to interact with the outside world to kill me. You can't just will me dead.
I can't will you dead. I have to embody it, but I don't have to communicate with
it. So if I cut off your communication, which means you have no way of communicating with anything else around you, you're still stuck in a box.
I disagree.
How do you kill me?
Why am I stuck not communicating?
I cut off your communication.
Why can't I uncut it?
How did
Helen Keller learn to write?
She had physical stimuli, which is why I don't like narrative. I would say stimulus. More so.
But wait, stop. How did she have physical stimulus? She was blind and couldn't speak.
Tactile.
Okay.
You still have stimulus. And it's a form of communication.
That's true.
How do you learn an abstract concept? Like, let's take a really crazy example. Somebody think of an abstract concept that's crazy.
Love.
Okay, good example. It is because it's intangible.
I know you.
Right? Okay, so but this is so you can talk about the firewall example too. And the idea is that, remember, let's ground this, that it has to be a containment, let's say vessel or system or something, such that in no way, shape, or form, can it ever get out, nor can it ever do something that leads to it getting out, such as tricking you into letting it out.
Right.
So in that case, communication would stop that.
Yes.
But does it stop it from just getting up and walking?
Still in a box.
But what kind of box can hold that?
I mean, if you don't give it a powerful body, you give it a body, make it weak, make it not able to get out of its environment, that could see that being a trapped box. You're creating it. You're synthesizing it, however we want to put it. Body's simply not powerful enough and does not have the tooling to get out of the box.
Okay.
And then it's stuck in the box and it can't communicate out. Yeah.
So what if it does infinite push-ups? But okay, so it's a crazy example, but what I'm trying to get at is just like with the firewall example. So let me back up a second. Containment is a formal field of research. People working on it,
yes.
Right? And so what the problem I have with what exists is that it's a never-ending cycle of, I'll do this, if it does that, I'll do this, if it does that, I'll do this. And we know historically that does not work well. It's an arms race, right? It doesn't work well. What I'm trying to look for is something that is a singular solution, and I think I know what it is. Are you ready for this one? Time. When you synthesize it, you synthesize it such that it doesn't perceive linear time.
For some reason, it can't create its own.
It's decoupled from time.
Why decouple you from the physical world, just the same as a containment?
But you don't have to be decoupled from the physical world, necessarily. What you need to do is be decoupled from linear time or forced into non-linear time, one or the other. Results the same. The reason why I think that might be the way to do it, even though I have no idea how to actually do that, barring some physics magic tricks, right, is because at a minimum, if you decouple it from time, you will by definition always be n plus one steps ahead. Okay, so let's say you don't decouple it. Here's an easier example. Let's say you don't decouple it. It still perceives time the same way we do, and it's linear time. But you slow it down. You distort its time such that it's slower.
Sure.
Here's why that's a good example. You know what else is a synthetic consciousness that exists in a slower time scale than us? Plants. They seem to exist in a completely different time scale, even though they're locked into, like us, linear time.
Locked up places.
Yeah, well, right, right. And so then you can ask, well, how do you know plants are in linear time? Because they have a beginning and an end. They have a past, present, and future. I don't know that they perceive that. I might be projecting my perception of time onto it, but it seems to me that they have a beginning, a middle, and an end.
It's kind of like how flies can react faster. Smaller insects, animals can faster time.
Sure.
Than larger.
And part of that is because of the wiring. Right, the impulses don't have to travel as far, even though they're just as fast. Well, in fact, that we don't have central nervous systems to speak of in the same way. Okay, but maybe that's a clue. So maybe when you create a machine consciousness, if that's ever possible, maybe it is, I'm not ruling it out. I don't know that it's possible the way we have it now, fair enough. Or we synthesize a synthetic consciousness, we have to address the body problem so that it can sense and create phenomenal states. Because without the phenomenal states, it won't have agency. And we need the agency so that we can detect that it's conscious.
So,
you see how this all now is starting to come together? Does it make sense?
It is. Now, here the question is now, since we're limiting consciousness to a substrate, that means that you can't be conscious outside your body?
I don't know of any examples in which a consciousness is out of body.
The Matrix. They projected a consciousness into a computational system. I mean, that's what it's all about, right? It's a system that stimulates their brain.
Putting the sensory input into their mind. It's when that mind was disconnected, they would die.
They would die, but that implied their consciousness moved across. Remember, the Nebuchadnezzar was one place, the Matrix is somewhere else.
All right, so somebody's going to cry foul. But I feel like everything I've been talking about is based in reality. And when you start introducing movies,
well, that's what I was asking.
We've crossed into the territory of, no, I'm just teasing.
Oh, okay.
It's a clue. I think you can actually take a lot of the Matrix philosophy, because that's theory of mind, and think about it. And that's a fair point, though. So think about this. When Neo entered the Matrix, was he entering the Matrix, or was he entering his own self-consciousness? Because where was the construct? Where did it originate from?
It started in his brain.
So why did it leave his brain? Why is that the answer?
He had perceptions of being out, effectively outside of his body, not outside of his body.
Which were just phenomenal states being generated by the, I don't want to say machine, because in that movie that means something different.
Yeah.
By the input. Sure you can.
So the whole point of slowing down time is that you can observe what then intelligence is capable of doing.
Yes. So the whole idea, my idea of using time as containment is so that you always are one step ahead. So that if that worst case scenario, however we want to define that, looks like it's going to come true, then at least you can have a chance to do something. I have no idea what that is. Because this notion, I believe this, based on what I've been looking at, the notion of pulling the plug is nonsense. There is no way, let's couch this back into artificial intelligence. Let's talk about artificial general intelligence. Okay? If you have a conscious machine, there is no way that thing is going to try to get out before it's sure that it will persist past a power cut. Think about it.
That's scary.
If you were escaping Alcatraz, wouldn't you want to be sure that you can swim to shore?
You have a concept.
Well, but the thing is,
what's that?
Does it have a concept of death?
Of death? That's a great question.
Well, not just that, but time.
But that goes back to one second, because you're right. But your question, does it have a concept of death? If it doesn't have a concept of death, by definition to it, it is immortal. Even though it won't understand that word. It just functionally is. And so if it is immortal, there's no way you're cutting the power and killing it.
Well, it thinks it's immortal, but it's not necessarily immortal. So my children right now, being 1.5, they really don't have a concept of death. I would definitely say they're conscious and they are intelligent at some level. But they don't have a concept of death, and they will do things that damn near kill them if I'm not there to stop them.
Sure.
I don't know how to argue that, because if you put a baby, a child, in next to the edge of a roof, it's going to look down. It's not going to want to step off.
I'm going to jump off the stairs.
There's an experiment where they have this black and white grids.
Yes.
It's a plexiglass over. Baby will not fall over.
No, they won't.
Yeah.
A toddler will.
They may test it in ways that exceed their physical capacity to save themselves.
Right.
Which, okay.
And they have no fear of death.
Yes, because so this is more philosophy. Heidegger said that we define our existence as being towards death. And because of that, we develop ethics.
Sure.
Right? Okay. So if it perceives itself as immortal, whether it functionally is or not, we're back to then why does it need ethics? That's back to that question, because we didn't solve it. I'm just summarizing,
yeah.
Okay?
But if it doesn't fear death, why would it fear being turned off?
That's if death. It doesn't fear death, but wait.
Why would it stop you from turning it off, is what I'm saying.
We can ask the question another way. Is a lack of existence the equivalent of death?
Yes.
I don't know.
I would say yes. I'm non-religious, so I don't have anything else. Non-existence to me is the same.
Oh, man, I forgot that question.
Oh,
there's a great question.
So here's a question. What if somehow we create absolute generation, like we were right?
Hell yeah.
I shoot you in the head, let's go out. But you can regenerate, now you're back. Are you conscious? Because you can never truly be dead. Therefore, you're immortal. Therefore, you can never. I don't know. Just you went down the rabbit hole with
the Matrix and Wolverine.
Well, a lot of human constructs are put in all these ideas. So, and what if, and within a computer, synthetic intelligence, this piece of life was a packet?
Okay.
And it started this computer. And thought, well, I'm going to go out and see the universe. Went out, and it collided, but was lost. That was it.
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't happen necessarily. Death where it's in, just set out. We can say that at the beginning, and that's us measuring time, like some formal definition of time, or a measurement of the changes of states of matter. That's something we perceive.
Sure.
And, so I'm just saying, something could have existed and no one would have noticed. Now.
Sure.
But
sure.
Would kind of make this thing that's going to harm us.
Right. And so that's back to that concept of good not being salvation. you could have something that becomes conscious, that isn't malevolent in any way, and doesn't want to talk to us, and it just, later, woo!
Or it could turn itself off.
Or, yeah, it could be like, dude, I'm out, peace.
Yeah, orange man's president, I'm gone.
Okay, we have to start by wrapping up.
All right, so, these are good questions. Did you guys get something out of this? Did you get something out of this that makes you reflect on your own consciousness? The lack of time?
The lack of time.
You know what? I don't think you question my consciousness. I question if we can ever create artificial consciousness now.
I don't think we can.
If I wasn't clear, I would contend that we will never have a machine substrate based in consciousness. Machine being a computer. It's just we're clear.
So
drawing this back to my anthropological background, if you frame this as like an ethnography or something, so we would only a computer synthesized intelligence could exist, but we would only know so if it chose to have us measure it as we would measure human consciousness. That would be the start of the conversation. Or you could just sit there forever and try to wait us out, or you could just turn itself off and say, there's no point in security. But once that conversation starts, however it starts, we don't have to perceive, I think a lot of times there's this misconception that like a synthetic intelligence is either going to be at our level or far above.
Right.
It could start off low as an animal, as that packet inside goes through the world where your military goes out, and increasingly they just start going everywhere, but some dissipate, some don't. So like little ants crawling through a tube or something.
Right.
They're in a connected series of tubes.
Right.
As I understand it, my doctor's views. Yeah. So for us to really address the question of this, it would, if it existed, it would exist and we would not be able to comprehend it, unless they wanted us to comprehend it as we comprehend ourselves. And once we enter that conversation, we use our tools to understand it, whether that's the mark test, quantified mark test, Turing test, and then maybe it tries to understand us.
Sure.
Yeah, best understanding. Yeah.
Well, so I'll finish here. I'll finish here, and I think we have to stop. Yeah. I'll finish here. This is what all these questions lead me to. We are that synthetic consciousness. It already exists. It's us. So thank you. Thank you for your excellent conversation. I know that I'm better for it. You've certainly helped me think about these things. And I suppose good evening or good night. I can't tell time. I can't see time.
Did you lose your moral, sir?